Thank you. God, thank you for giving us a time to worship you today. Praise your name on high. Resting within your arm, we are going to listen to you with all our heart. Holy Spirit, help and lead us to seek his message through our Pastor Brian's lips and fix our body, thoughts, and spirit. Lord, let us be awakened from the darkness and repent our sins before you. Your word and grace is enough to win the spiritual warfare. Lord, we want to seek your wisdom and plan to us through our daily routines. Finding your vision, let our eyes sparkle and see your kingdom come. Let us be prepared and encouraged to say yes for your calling, and give us your strength to overcome the accompanying sufferings as well. Let us break through the limits set by ourselves and accomplish your great commission given to us. Lord, let us look after one another and respond in a sensitive way. Give us clean and pure heart for intercessory prayer. Bless us as we grow within you by having daily quiet devotions times, concentrating on Sunday sermons, and sharing our lives in small groups. And let us open our heart and give warm welcomes to your lost sheep, the newcomers you are sending to our ministry. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
This is the time to say greetings to each other. Look around yourself.
Okay, if you'd like to, you could stand up and tell us your name and where you're from.
My name is Steven. I'm from Russia originally.
Okay.
It's my first time this year. I was here 2 years ago.
Okay. You were, okay. Well, welcome back. Good to see you again. All right, and thank you for that representative prayer from Woon Ho. Next week's representative prayer will be given by Susie Yu from Sunday School Team. Again, please check your body temperature before you enter this hall. And this year's first offline small group fellowship will be held after service. And OEM wants as many people as possible to attend the fellowship. Okay.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Today's sermon is about the passage in the living life. So I hope you guys all read the passage that I sent you. Just in case, let me briefly explain the contents of the passage for this week. So the passage for this week was about Moses. And if I briefly explain the story of Moses. Moses was a Hebrew guy who grew up as a prince of Egypt. So when he saw an Egyptian soldier beating Hebrew, he killed that Egyptian soldier. So after that, he was afraid. He was afraid, and he thought that what he had done would become known to others. So he ran away from Egypt and went to Midian. And after he lived there for 40 years, God appeared out of bush, and he told Moses to go back to Egypt and deliver his people from Egypt. Moses doubted himself and could not fully trust God. And today's passage shows us how God helps his people when they struggle with doubt and question about God. So, Michael, can you read today's passage?
Indeed I can. Now go. I will help you speak and will teach you what to say. But Moses said, "Pardon your servant, Lord. Please send someone else." Then the Lord's anger burned against Moses, and he said, "What about your brother, Aaron the Levite? I know he can speak well. He is already on his way to meet you, and he will be glad to see you. You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. He will speak to the people for you, and it will be as if he were your mouth, and as if you were God to him. But take this staff in your hand, so that you can perform the signs with it." Then Moses went back to Jethro, his father-in-law, and said to him, "Let me return to my own people in Egypt, and see if any of them are still alive." Jethro said, "Go, and I wish you well." Now the Lord had said to Moses in Midian, "Go back to Egypt, for all those who wanted to kill you are dead." So Moses took his wife and sons and put them on a donkey and started back to Egypt. And he took the staff of God in his hand. The Lord said to Moses, "When you return to Egypt, see that you perform before Pharaoh all the wonders I have given you power to do. But I will harden his heart so that he will not let the people go. Then say to Pharaoh, 'This is what the Lord says: Israel is my firstborn son, and I told you, let my son go, so he may worship me. But you refused to let him go. So I will kill your firstborn son.'"
When I read the story of Moses when I was young, I thought Moses lacked faith because he was reluctant to follow God's calling, even though God showed miracles right in front of his eyes. So I used to question Moses, why is he so doubtful? And why can't he just answer God's calling, even though God told him that he's going to be with him? But as I grew up, I also had to face this kind of situations. God told me to go, but I hesitated to say yes. And as I saw myself hesitating to say yes, I realized that I am pretty doubtful too. God told me to go to the Philippines when I was young, and he told me to go to the States, and later he called me back here to Korea. And whenever I moved to different country, I always had to start from zero. So not enough money, no house, no car. And every time I moved, nothing was guaranteed. So it was hard for me to just follow God's calling without doubting. Especially when I come back to Korea at this time, I had my own family that I had to take care of. So it was hard for me to just make a decision to come back to Korea. Because I was not sure if I could take care of my family without having no job and anything else. So I questioned God. God, are you sure about this? Are you calling me back to Korea even though you miss what it means to me? But church, it is not only for Moses or me. Every one of us struggle with doubt, and we all question God. We doubt ourselves, we doubt our ability, even though all our power comes from Christ in us. And often we also doubt God and his ability, as Moses did in today's passage. However, through today's passage, the Bible clearly shows us how trustful God is and why he is the only God we can trust. So today, I want this time to be the moment that we can remind ourselves how trustful God is and why he is the one and only God who can be trusted. First, we can trust God because God is the one who can empower his people until they they can accomplish God's calling. Actually, Moses had already tried once to save the Hebrews before he was called by God. But at that time, he tried to do it in his own ability and wisdom. So, as you guys know, you know how that ended up, just as the murder that Moses had to cover up. So when Moses doubted himself, actually it was natural response, because he already experienced failure, right? And when God called Moses, he was already 80 years old. So his physical ability was for sure not as good as when he was young. So for all these reasons, Moses doubted himself. But God gave abilities to Moses so that he could accomplish his calling. First, God taught him what to say. Verse 12 says, can you go to the next slide? Yep. Verse 12 says, now go, I will help you speak and will teach you what to say. All Moses needed to do was just go. Just to go. And can you go to the next slide? Acts chapter 7 verse 22 says, Moses was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was powerful in speech and action. God had been with Moses since he was a baby growing up in Pharaoh's court. God had been teaching Moses to speak since before Moses even knew God. Isn't it amazing? So God empowered Moses through teaching him what to say. And Moses would go on to show great leadership through his outstanding speeches to Israel. And through his confidence speaking God's word boldly, even when he was standing right in front of Pharaoh. Second, God empowered Moses to do signs and wonders so that all people in Egypt and Pharaoh would know that the Israel's God is the one, only one and the most powerful God. Verse 20 says, so Moses took his wife and sons, put them on a donkey and started back to Egypt. And he says, and he took the staff of God in his hand. In the story of Israel's liberation from Egypt, the staff of Moses is more than a prop. Over and over and over, Moses showed God's power through the staff. If you see, can you go to the next slide? If you see chapter 7, verse 20, it says, Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord had commanded. He raised his staff in the presence of Pharaoh and his officials and struck the water of the Nile, and all the water was changed into blood. And chapter 8, verse 5 says, then the Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron, stretch your hand with your staff over the streams and canals. And chapter 14, verse 16 says, raise your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea to divide the water so that the Israelites can go through the sea on the dry land, ground. And chapter 17, verse 5 to 6 also shows that Moses used the staff to strike the rock for the water to come out from the rock. Whenever Moses did signs on behalf of God, he used the staff of God. The staff that he carried for his whole journey in the wilderness. But it does not mean that staff itself has the power, but it means that the staff was the power of God handed to Moses. When Moses tried to save Hebrews in his own strength, it didn't work. But when Moses went back to Egypt and tried again with words and wisdom that God gave him, the result was different. The whole nation of Israel went free, walked right out of Egypt, the strongest country in the world at the time. And Moses led and took care of 600,000 Israelites in the wilderness. Church, this is the power of Christ, the power of God. But don't think that it is just Moses. The Bible tells us very clearly that God empowers us too. Can you go to the next slide? Philippians chapter 4 verse 13 says, I can do all this through him who gives me strength. And Psalm chapter 29 verse 11 says, the Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord blesses his people with peace. Do you believe in the word of God? Do you believe that everything that is written in the Bible is true? In church, nothing is impossible if God empowers you. The ministry that God gives us, what he calls us to do to serve him in his word, this word might seem hard for us to accomplish, but when God empowers you, the power of God will overflow in you for you to live the life that can glorify God through accomplishing the ministry that God gave you. So church, when you feel like the ministry that God gives you is too much of a burden, all you need to do is trust God. Because he will for sure give strength to his people as he did to his Moses, to Moses, today's passage. Second, the reason why we have to trust God is that he is the greatest and most powerful God. In today's passage, I think the most interesting verse is verse 21. Verse 21 says, the Lord said to Moses, when you return to Egypt, see that you perform before Pharaoh all the wonders I have given you the power to do. But I will harden his heart so that he will not let the people go. Think about this. If God's goal was only the liberation of Israelites from Egypt, why would he harden Pharaoh's heart? Why wouldn't he just force Pharaoh to free the Israelites? In order to know the answer to this answer of these questions, we have to take a look at the 10 plagues carefully. Actually, it's a little misleading to call them plagues, because we should call them signs and wonders, because those are the actual words the Bible uses most of the time. And these signs and wonders that God did through Moses in Egypt were not only for punishment of the disobedience of Pharaoh, but they were also proof that God, the God of Israel, was the most powerful God. At this time, Egyptians served and worshipped many different kind of gods, including worshipping the Pharaoh as a god. And because Egyptian was one of the strongest country at that time in this region, the Egyptian's religious culture influenced the Israelites too. Therefore, through all the signs of wonders that Moses did, God proved to the Egyptians and all people that he alone is the King of Kings and God of Gods. Let's go one by one through the 10 signs so that we can see how powerful this was. First, the Egyptians served the Nile River as one of their gods. Because water was so rare around that area, they saw the Nile River as blessing of their country. So God changed all the water in the Nile River into blood. And second, the Egyptians believed that the frog was the goddess of fertility. They thought the frog represented fruitfulness and blessing. So through bringing all the frog out of Nile, God quickly turned what was pleasant and desirable to loathsome. Third, the Egyptians served the earth as one of their gods. They gave offering to the earth for the bounty of the soil. Yet, it was the soil that the next sign originated from. God struck the dust of the earth, and it became like notch on the man and all the livestock. Fourth, the Egyptians served the flies as one of their gods. Yet God used these flies for the fourth sign. And fifth, the Egyptians had a lot of livestock that they used as their food and transportations. So, and even when they worshipped before their God, especially they saw the cow as God of manifestation. So God killed all the livestock in the field. And sixth, The Egyptian served a god named Imhotep, and he was the god of medicine. So God proved that he was far stronger through spreading the skin diseases to all the Egyptians that no one in Egypt could cure. Seventh, the Egyptians served the sky as one of their gods. They believed that the god of sky brought them rain, and they treated rain as divine blessing. So God sent a hailstorm unlike any other. At eighth, there was a god in Egypt named Set, who was the protector of crops. So God sent so many locusts that the land was darkened, and all the crops that had been left after the hail were destroyed. And ninth, for all the Egyptians' god, the god of the sun, Ra, was one of the strongest gods. So God cast darkness over Egypt. And of course, the last sign, the Egyptians believed that the Pharaoh was true living human form god. So God proved that he is the only god through killing the firstborn of Pharaoh. Through all these plagues, God showed all the Egyptians and all his people that God is the most powerful and unbeatable God. And through this story, the Bible proves to us that he is the only and true God, and that he is above all names. And this is the reason why God is the one who we can trust the most. When I was doing military service, I was a minesweeper. And one day, I heard that there was an open position as translator. So I wanted to apply for that job, because if I get that job, I could travel other countries too. But my company commander didn't allow me to apply for that job, because she wanted someone who can speak in English to be in her company. So I just gave up. But a few weeks later, I visited my family for the vacation. And I shared the story that happened in the military camp to my family. And when my uncle heard that story, he told me that one of his friends was a high-ranking officer. So he called his friend and had him back me up. And of course, when I returned to the military camp, I knew that I had a support. So I went straight to the company commander, my company officer, and told her again that I want to apply for that translating job. And at the time, she already had gotten a call from my uncle's friend, so she let me apply for the job. We feel more safe and confident when we know that someone who has power backs us up, right? And furthermore, when someone who has power backs us up, we can really do something that we cannot do by ourselves. Unfortunately, I did not get the translating job in the end, but maybe if the one who got my bag is the president of Korea, maybe I could get that job. Church, who has our back? Who has our back? Who's backing us up? We need to always remember that the one who got our back is the most powerful King of Kings. He's the one who created all things and reigns over the whole world. Everywhere you can reach is his kingdom, and everything and all people we see are under his sovereignty. He's the one and only true God in the whole universe, and that is the God who is backing us up. If you see verse 22 and 23, it says, "Then say to Pharaoh, this is what the Lord says, Israel is my firstborn son, and I told you, let my son go, so he may worship me, but you refuse to let him go, so I will kill your first son." From this verse, we can see that God fights for his sons and daughters. And 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18 clearly declares, "I will be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters, says to the Lord Almighty." Church, we are sons and daughters of God, and he is our father. Fathers always look after their kids, and they are willing to sacrifice themselves to save their kids. I still remember when I was hospitalized because of peritonitis. Have you guys ever heard about that sickness, peritonitis? So I was hospitalized because of that, and then I was in pain for like a couple of weeks. So when I was hospitalized, I still remember that my father prayed to God every day in tears that please take him instead of me. And later, after I became dead, my first boy, Haim, he could not pass hearing tests for a long time. So at the time, I begged God to take my ear instead of his. If you see verse 23, we can see that God is willing to fight with anyone who makes his sons and daughters struggle. And even when Israelites were in the wilderness, God provided food and water and looked after them through the pillars of cloud and pillars of fire. He was patient with his children's mistake and always gave all his effort to show his children how much he loves them. Church, this is what fathers do. And the Almighty God is Father of ours. As we finish this sermon, let's remind ourselves who we really have to trust and rely on. Church, we can trust and rely on the one who is strong and powerful enough to take care of us and give us the ability to accomplish our calling as Christians. The one who really loves us as his sons and daughters. And obviously that is no one but God. The one who set his people free from slavery in Egypt and who still set us free today. God is the most powerful King of Kings, the one who created and reigns over the whole universe. And that God strengthens and empowers us so that the power of God overflowing us for his people to accomplish the calling of God because he loves us so much as his real sons and daughters. So church, what is your calling? What is the ministry that God handed to you? When you live to accomplish God's calling, there will be a lot of problems, struggles, and difficulties in your life. But I encourage you to always remember that God is way bigger than all those problems. And he is willing to give you the power to overcome all the hardship because he loves you more than anything. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for being our God. We trust you because you are the most powerful God who reigned over all your kingdoms. Because you are our Father who loves and helps us. Help us to have stronger faith, to trust and rely on you in every situation, especially when we accomplish your calling as your sons and daughters, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Father, you are the giver of all good things.
And your word makes clear that every good and perfect gift comes from you. Nothing we give matches your glory and majesty and the great gift of your Son Jesus and the Holy Spirit which guides us daily. All we have is yours, and we ask that you would use us and all we have as you will. We also ask that these offerings be used to spread the gospel and for the growth of your kingdom on earth and in heaven. Amen.
Let's close today's service through the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.